Together, we want to continue to praise the Lord, to join with all the earth, all of creation, in singing praises to His name. He lived, He died, He said in 3 days He would rise. He did. He's alive. Let's sing together.
You live, You died, You said in 3 days You would rise. You did. You're alive. Said You're coming back again. I know You will. All the earth will sing Your praises. All the earth will sing Your praises.
You give Your life away for us.
You took, You take our sins away, oh God. You gave Your life away for us. You came down, You saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of Your great love. You live, You died, You said in 3 days. I know you will, all the earth will sing your praises.
All the earth.
All the earth will sing your praises. Take our sins away, oh God. You gave your life away for us. You came down, you saved us through the cross. Our hearts are changed because of your grace.
Praise you, Jesus.
Amen. Man, look at this. Almost a full house. It just kind of means a little more today, doesn't it? Doesn't it just sort of feel like that? And I'm so glad you're here. I want to welcome you today. Why don't you take a seat for a minute? When you came in the door, somebody handed you a worship guide, and there's a tearaway tab on that guide. If you want to know more about Grace Life, feel free to let us know who you are, and if we can answer any questions for you, we'd be honored to do that. If you want to find out a lot about Grace Life, you can sign up for our next membership class, which comes up in April. You can check the box on that tab that you want to be a part of that. If you have a prayer need, you can write that on the green tab today as well. You'll be able to drop all those in the offering plates later. Or if you want to just be anonymous, you know, maybe you're here today. Maybe your church family wasn't able to have church on campus today, and so you wanted to be in a house of worship somewhere, then welcome. We're so glad that you're here. This week has been crazy. I've been a bit insulated from it over the weekend. I'm drinking hot tea right now. This is the sixth time, this next moment I preach will be the sixth time I've preached this weekend. I've been at University of West Alabama over the weekend getting to preach there to an incredible group of college students, and they hooked me up with some great UWA swag, man. I mean, I got a hoodie, and I got this, and I got like three t-shirts, and so I appreciate, I think they said the basketball coach did that, and I appreciate being aware of that today. So got to lead a college young man to Christ yesterday after amen. I love y'all get excited about that, right? Yeah. He came up after the service. He said, man, I got to talk to you. And we went in a room, and he just broken, man, just broken. He said, my dad's a preacher, missionary, and I've been living a lie my whole life, been living a lie. And God saved him, and he called his family yesterday and shared with them. And this morning, right before the first service started, he texted me to just let me know he was praying for me and praying for y'all today. And so So I really appreciate that. So I've had a great weekend, and just continuing to serve the Lord. And I know you've been doing the same. You've been serving the Lord in the madness of everything that's going on. Man, what tremendous opportunities God's putting before us to let the light of Jesus shine. And if you're not here with us today, you're at home live streaming, maybe you're not feeling well, or you've got some physical concerns for you or for members of your family, or maybe because of what you do for a living, we're glad you're there, okay? We want the Holy Spirit to guide us all in these days, and for Him to speak through our conscience and tell us where we need to be and what we should do and what we shouldn't do. And what I don't want Grace Life to do is to be judgy at anybody, because other people may be processing this in different ways. All of our family structures are different. All of our dynamics are different. There's thousands of variables in every life about this situation. So if you are tempted to be critical that we're worshiping here today, please give us grace. And if you're tempted to be critical of those who might have chosen that it was wiser not to assemble together today, we're not going to be critical of that either. Amen? Today is a tremendous opportunity with so much attention that's being given this morning to what our church is doing today. And so many churches like us, live streaming and broadcasting out. And we're thankful for our partners in gospel ministry. Wouldn't it be something today if the greatest virus that hit the world was that the gospel went viral today all over the world? Amen. Wouldn't that be great? And I'm praying for that. And I hope you'll pray for that too. If we've learned anything this week, it's that the world in just a matter of hours can all be talking about the same thing. And how wonderful would it be that if in the next few hours the whole world was talking about Jesus? Amen. I believe God will do that. He can do that. I believe He wants to do that. And here's what's stunning to me. He wants to do that through our lives. What a privilege that God has set before us. So the situation is constantly changing. And so we're not projecting today what we're going to do next Sunday. We've already seen folks who've made decisions and then unmade those decisions and made decisions, because that's just how rapidly everything seems to be changing. So right now, we've got a whole week in front of us before what we decide what we're going to do next Sunday. Now, I just so you know me, I love y'all. I love seeing y'all. I love worshiping with y'all. I just love being here. This is the way my weeks start out. I wouldn't change that for anything in the world. And so if things have to change next week, I'm not making any promises, but I lean more toward figuring out how we offer more worship services to dilute the numbers of people in the crowd so that we can continue to gather. That's a possibility that could be on the table. Or God's going to just heal the land and we're back to normal next week, whatever that looks like. Obviously, canceling altogether is something that's on the table, but we're not there yet. So probably I'll send out a message next Friday, sort of like I did this past Friday, so you got some time to think about that. But as far as I'm concerned, we'll find an oak tree and just get outside and come on, right? And don't let the allergy season make you think you got the virus, okay? That's what's happened with me. My voice is hoarse, and I'm ingesting a whole lot of pollen. So we're going to be all good. But I'm so thankful. One of our local pastors called me today and asked for prayer. They don't have the capability of live streaming, and their congregation's elderly, and he's I can't keep them from hugging each other, you know. So there's just a whole lot of variables in people's lives. But I'm really thankful for what God's doing through the body of believers that I know. I'm just seeing pastors lead well and churches rally and people supporting each other and reaching out and caring for each other. So I believe God's going to take what maybe the enemy meant for evil, and He's going to do great things to show the world who He is and His glory and His might. So I will tell you this, we have made one decision, or a couple of, well, probably lots of decisions. Our mission team's not going to Thailand. That was a good call. And our mission team's not going to Belize either. That's also a good call. Not just because of concern for us. You'll find out in a minute just how remote a village our Belize team was about to go into. And the last thing that we would want to do is take something from here to them. So out of love for them, we can delay that for a little while. So we're saddened that we have to make some changes there. Also, this week is spring break for about half of our students. The week after that is spring break for the other half of our students. And so a lot of people are going out of town. And what that means is that during those 2 weeks, our Wednesday night kids, nursery, student ministries were operating on a skeletal crew already. And with everything else going on, that may be even more complicated. So we thought it the best and wisest decision to just suspend our Wednesday night activities for the next 2 Wednesday nights. And then we'll see where we go from there. My Bible study, daytime Bible study, is canceled right now because it syncs up with the students' Wednesday night study. And my 8 o'clock Sunday school class next Sunday, I'm canceling it. But we're not canceling any other Sunday stuff yet. I'm just trying to keep my Bible study synced up. So I'm kind of an oddity, I guess, in that way. So I'm so glad I got to see your faces today because, again, I didn't really know a lot of what's going on in the world. I don't do social media, so I don't know what the scuttlebutt around here's been. I knew I put out a message, and I didn't know what people said about that or thought about that. And so I just didn't know what's it going to be like today. And I'm so glad you're here. I got to see your beautiful, lovely faces, and we get to worship Jesus together. So I say we get after it. What do you say? Amen. Let's go. Let's stand. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we're just thrilled, God, that you are our God and you're our King. You're our Savior because of what Jesus has done. And God, we're happy to be in this place today. We count it a gift, God, that we get to do this. Lord, we know that there's so many hearts that are heavy because they couldn't be here today. It wouldn't be the wisest decision for them to make. And God, I pray that you would step in to their hearts right now in this moment. And God, that they would know your presence from wherever they may be joining us in worship or joining, God, other churches that are navigating this like we are. God, I know that there's a sense of loss with some that they're not with their church family today. And we just pray, God, that you would just manifest your presence in living rooms and bedrooms throughout this land. We do pray that the name of Jesus would go forth today like never before. God, this just seems like this would be the very sort of thing that you would flip to exalt the Lord Jesus. And God, we want to see it happen. We want to see an awakening in the world to the gospel, to you, like never before. God, we're seeing people come to Christ in these days. We want to see that, God. I'm convinced that your word, what Jesus said, the fields are ready to be harvested. We don't have a harvest problem. We have a harvester problem. So God, would you call us out into the world that we live in now to find ways to show your love and to boldly speak of your love, to boldly share the name of Jesus. There is no other name like his name. There's no other name under heaven by which we're saved. At the name of Jesus, diseases flee and demons tremble. And we want the name of Jesus to be exalted, God, in this place and all across the world today. There is none like you, Jesus. And it's your name alone that we exalt, your name alone that we lift up in this place. Jesus, be magnified, be pleased, be honored, be glorified. You're so good, and you alone are worthy of that. It is for you and for you alone, for your great name, Jesus. And we ask it in that great name. And all God's people said, amen. Come on, let's worship.
Lost or saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned. Your great name.
Oh, you called me out of darkness. You silence every lie. And no other voice will define me. And I belong to you. I belong to you. Oh, you call me out of darkness. You silence every lie. And no other voice will define me. I belong to you. Taking on your name, and I need to be reminded that I belong to you. Yeah, I belong to you. You know the enemy can't take what I have, change who I.
Ushers, let's do it this way today, all right? So if you'll get the plates, and let's put one on the front row of that section and one on the front row of this section, and one over here is already by Joy, and one over here on this section. And instead of passing those plates, while the children are coming up here to join us for the children's moment, if you brought an offering today, I know a lot of you are doing this online. That's a great way to do that, so we're grateful for that. But if you brought your offering today, then just come on and just set it in here. That way, we're not all passing this plate, all right, because I love y'all, but I'd want a pump of that sanitizer up before I got a hold of that plate. And I tell you, if nothing else from all this, when it's all, I hadn't been, you know, I'm a little bit of a germaphobe, not big time, but come on, boys and girls, come on up here. But when all this stuff subsides, I'm going to hug the fire out of y'all. So just brace yourself for that day. I'm coming at you, you know, hard and fast on that day, all right? Even some of you ugly folks. I'm coming for you. I'm just going to hug you, all right? All right? I'm just kidding. Ain't none of y'all ugly. Huh? You've never had the fire hugged out of you? You probably have. You just didn't know it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it means you hug them hard. Like, man, I've missed you. Hey, guys, y'all good? What are y'all going to do for school, man? I bet all you homeschool kids are really aggravated about now. Like, man, this is not fair. Oh, Lord, where is the justice in all this, right? So we're sad that the Belize trip is postponed for right now, but Ms. Hannah had you guys ready for this. And so, Ms. Hannah, let's talk about it.
Yeah, no, we're bummed, but we know God's timing is perfect and he has a plan and his ways are higher than our ways. So even though we're sad, we're not going to be there next week. God has a purpose for all of that. I wanted to tell you guys a little bit about our Belize night. We had another Belize night, and we had our kids write friendship letters again to the kids in the villages in Belize that we were going to take these letters to. And you guys, I think a lot because you've seen them open your letters like on videos, and you see how much like they cherish it, and they look at your letters so closely. Our kids did such a good job. They're so intentional and thoughtful about what they wrote, and I can tell it's like their very best handwriting and their best drawings, and they're just giving their best while they did this. But yeah, so we have a video of a village that we were going to hike into. It's called Machukla Hall. Can y'all say Machukla Hall? I think I'm saying that the right way, but so I have a video, and it's very southern Belize, and we still have plans to make it out there, but we're just not this trip, and just to go visit this village and visit those people and the pastors there. So here's a video of that place.
The inaccessible village of Machukla is one of the most economically depressed communities in southern Belize. With a total population of 105 residents, the livelihoods of many, if not all of those who live here, is based on agriculture.
Well, the parents choose to come and live here in Machukla. They like the area. It's lowland area, and everything that grows here, especially rice, these parents are always interested in planting rice and corn, and that is what they usually do, and especially raising cattle as well. That is their interest, and the place is open, and we're all Belizeans, so I think we believe that we can use the land wherever we wish to.
Its remoteness, however, cuts off Machukla from access to basic amenities, including potable water, electricity, and health care. The dire need for a road to be built goes beyond the students, who are forced to make the daily trek to the neighboring village of Dolores.
All they're asking for is the bare minimum to give them that true access that they're asking for. If you can imagine mothers, women, making this trek when they are pregnant and in their final term of pregnancy to access a hospital or a healthcare center, imagine making that trek. One has to understand when somebody dies, for example, the law mandates that you have to take your deceased to the nearest doctor so that they can certify death. Imagine having to carry and having to bring them back. And that is only because you will have to charter a vehicle from Dolores to get to the nearest healthcare center.
Realizing those hardships, young Alfonso Potul is intent on becoming a doctor. In the future, he wants to give back to his community in the service of others.
In my future, I want to become a doctor. And I want to work for myself, for my family, and for my community, and for my country. So I'm kindly asking the government to build Machukla a rock road as soon as possible. We want to be treated like others.
At the heart of the issue is the question of political will. These families, like others in Toledo District, are largely neglected, and their needs continue to go unnoticed.
These are families that have a very small cash flow. Their livelihood is land-based. Their livelihood, their dependence is on the forest and what they can, how they can make a life from the forest. And so all of this, in this context, you begin to realize that the magnitude of the problem and the struggle that these families are faced with.
Reporting for News 5, I am Isana Cayetano.
So we're not going there this coming week, but eventually we're going to get y'all's letters, and maybe some of those kids in the video will get to see their letters that you have written. So I wanted to share with you guys, because I know you like to hear some of the things that the kids write, because it's really great and also sometimes funny. So let's see. This is what I know about Jesus and what he has done for me. I know that Jesus has died for us and came back. 3 days later, Jesus has come into my heart. And this is kind of, they draw their picture and then they share how old they are and their favorite animal, favorite food, things that kids in Belize can pray for them, and things that they know about Jesus. And that was Sarah Hathaway. And then Addie wrote, this is what I know about Jesus and what he has done for me. He prays for me, makes food for me, makes houses for me, makes animals. She said her favorite food is pizza. And then Miles wrote, Jesus is real. Jesus has saved me and my mom and sister from a car crash. And I know he died for my sins and that he created me. And then I thought this was really cool. Lucas said, here's how you can pray for me. You can pray for me to get stronger in my faith with God. And he said, Jesus has given me a great family and he loves me and you. My favorite thing about God's creation is church, family, and friends. So I just wanted to share with you guys some of those things. And so even though our timing of going to Belize is a little different, we still have this awesome partnership with those pastors in Belize, and we're getting to make those connections with our friends in Belize. So I just wanted to share that with you guys today.
Fantastic. Thank you, Ms. Hannah. Let's invite Mr. Derek, if he would, to come and pray for us. And if you brought an offering today, boys and girls, you can give that to Mr. Derek. Thank you, sir.
All right. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for letting us all be here together today. Thank you for the ones that are watching us on live stream also. Please be with all of us to keep us safe, healthy, and strong for what's going on in the world today. And please cover our world, Lord. Please heal it, because we know you are the one true healer, because you are the one true God. Please continue to be with Brother Joel today as he brings us the message, and help us not only hear the message, but apply it to our lives each and every day, so that we'll be more like you. Please bless these tithes and offerings to continue building your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. See you later, boys and girls. If you have a Bible today, I'd ask you to turn to John chapter 18. This was prepared Wednesday before the whole world kind of went crazy Wednesday afternoon and Wednesday night. And we've been in the Gospel of John for 2 years now. We've taken a few breaks out of it. But here we are today in John chapter 18. I'll just jump to it here. Last week, we saw the religious trials of Jesus. They came and they arrested Jesus. And he went first before who the Jewish people considered to be their high priest, which was Annas. And he could not find any fault with Jesus, although they certainly were looking. And then he sent them to who Rome considered to be the high priest, which is Caiaphas, and then before the Sanhedrin. Where we are today is the religious trial has ended, and now the civil trial before Rome is beginning in verse 28. That's where we'll start, John 18, 28. Jesus' trial before Caiaphas ended in the early hours of the morning, and then he was taken to the headquarters of the Roman governor. Roman courts began at daybreak, and they went until the sun set. And so the Jewish leaders, they want to make sure that they get Jesus on the docket. And so they've got him there, first in line, first thing in the morning. And the Bible says that Jesus' accusers did not go inside the headquarters where Pilate was because it would defile them and they wouldn't be allowed to celebrate the Passover. The Passover is happening later that day. And the Jewish leaders believed that because Pilate and his people were Gentiles, that it would cause them to be ceremonially unclean if they went into a place where Gentiles lived and operated and worked. By the way, that's not something they learned from God. That's not something that came out of the Old Testament scriptures. That's what the Jewish rabbis had tacked on to that. This was just further withdrawing themselves from the nations of the earth, further withdrawing themselves from the Gentile people. Before social distancing was cool, they were social distancing themselves from the Jewish people, treating all the Gentile, or the Gentile people rather, the Jewish people were treating the Gentile people as if they all had the coronavirus, you know. So that's going to mess us up and defile us. Now here's the irony of it all. They're trying to murder the Son of God. And they're worried about being ceremonially unclean. Now the trial begins formally in verse 29. And just so you know, John is not writing this account like a court reporter. He's not interested in us knowing every single detail of the legal proceedings. That's not why John has written this gospel. If you remember all the way through our journey in the Gospel of John, we've talked about this verse, John chapter 20, verse 31. That's where John lays out the purpose for why he wrote this book. And there he says, "But these are written so that you may continue to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing in Him, you might have power in His name." So John says, the whole reason I wrote this gospel account is because I want you to know who Jesus is. And that was the name of our sermon series when we started this, Jesus Is. He wants us to know who Jesus is. And listen, if there's ever been a day where this is relevant, it's today. You and I are living in a moment in history that the world desperately needs to know who Jesus is. We're living in a moment in history where even the people of God today need to be reminded who Jesus is. We need some clarity just to cut through the madness of this moment, and we need to be reminded of who Jesus is. And so in this trial before Pilate, John's not giving us all the details of the legalities or illegalities of it all. He's showing us some truths about who Jesus is. And I want to show you five of those today. Five truths about who Jesus is that are revealed in this moment between him and Pilate at the judgment of Jesus, you might say. And here's the first one. John shows us that Jesus is the sinless king. He's the sinless king. No sin, no fault, no blame, no spot, no blemish about him whatsoever. Look at the text, verse 29. So Pilate, the governor, went out to them. They wouldn't come into him, so he goes out to them. And he asked him, "What is your charge against this man?" Great question. What are you accusing him of? You don't arrest somebody unless you're accusing him of something. So just tell me, just spit it out. What crime has this man committed? Now, as you know, if you know this story at all, Pilate is going to investigate. And no less than six times, Pilate's going to look at Jesus and say, "I find no fault in this man." A pagan politician can look at Jesus and six times is going to say, "I can't find the first thing wrong with him." Even Pilate's wife says to her husband, "You need to wash your hands of this man because he is innocent." She even knows that he's an innocent man. Pilate's a judge. He's been positioned to be a judge by Rome. He understands Roman law. He understands Roman justice. If there's one thing the Romans prided themselves on, it was their law. It was their judicial system. And Pilate has been given the responsibility from Rome to uphold justice and to uphold their judicial system. So here's the question. Why then does he cave in eventually and execute Jesus when after six times he says he's innocent? He hasn't done anything wrong. Well, I'll tell you the reason why. And I can't go into all the details of this because time just won't allow. Pilate had already taken some pretty egregious missteps when it came to the Jewish people. And every time he did, that backfired on him and went back to the chain of command. And he kept getting himself in trouble with his supervisors and with the Roman emperor. And so he was almost, you might say, kind of already on probation because of what he has done. And so he's in a hard place here now with the Jewish people. In fact, over in the next chapter, they're going to say to him in verse 12, if you let this man go, then we're going to tell on you. We're telling Caesar. We're going to make trouble. That's what they're saying to him. We're going to make trouble for you again. And so Pilate, as a politician, his career, his position, his power has gotten kind of wobbly. He's treading water now already. But Pilate's assuming there's got to be some kind of crime that's been committed. So he looks at the Jewish leaders and he says, so what's the crime? What are you accusing him of? And of course, that question is a big problem to the Jewish leaders because they have no crime. He's done nothing wrong. Man, they've looked for something. Believe you me, they've looked to dig up something on him, but they can't find anything. And they give this answer in verse 30. If you'll pay attention to the way they answered that question, Pilate goes, what's he accused of? They don't answer the question. Right? Sounds like court, right? You know? Just some legal maneuvering here. Here's how they answer the question in verse 30. Well, we wouldn't have handed him over to you if he weren't a criminal. See that? They ducked, they dodged, they diverted. In other words, they said, Pilate, are you accusing us of bringing an innocent man before you in handcuffs? You think we would do such a thing? Surely you're not calling our integrity into question, are you? Caesar would probably like to know about that, right? That's the implication of this whole thing. But there's no accusation. Jesus is spotless and sinless. He's the perfect Son of God. He's never done anything wrong. They couldn't find one single crime. This is John's way of reminding you and me today, Jesus is our sinless King. The people who hated him the most could not find anything wrong with him. The good news for us, that means because he had no sin of his own, he was qualified to take yours to the cross. He was qualified then to take my sin to the cross. And that's exactly what Jesus has done for us. Not only is Jesus the sinless King, but I want you to know he's the sovereign King. Man, if there's ever been a day we needed to be reminded of his sovereignty over us, it's today. Man, the world needs to hear that message. He is in control. That's what it means that he's sovereign. He is ruling. He is reigning. He is in control of all things. Look at verse 31. Pilate says to the people, then you take him away. And you judge him by your own law, Pilate told him. Do you understand what he just said to them? Look, y'all kill him if you want to kill him. Go by your laws then. Their law was the law of Moses. The law of Moses said that if you were going to accuse somebody of a crime that was worthy of capital punishment, the way you would be executed under capital punishment as a Jewish person is you would be thrown to the ground and you would be stoned. And so Pilate just gave him permission. Look, do with him whatever you want to do. Drag him out in the street and stone him. I don't care. Pilate knew they wanted to kill Jesus. He knew there was nothing wrong with Jesus. He didn't want to do it. Pilate's got some sense of justice. There's no crime that's been committed against Rome. He just says, look, I give you a pass. I don't want to deal with it. Just go. He's just trying to get out of the mess that he finds himself in. And the Jews come back and they say, verse 31, only the Romans are permitted to execute someone. They're right. But the Romans, by virtue of Pilate's authority, just gave them, in this moment, in this situation, a pass to go do it. Pilate had judicial liberty to be able to do things like that if he wanted to do things like that. And so he, with a wink and a nod, said, look, I'll turn my head. You go do whatever you want to do. But they don't take Pilate's offer. Why not? Why wouldn't they, in their hatred toward Jesus, just drag him out in the street and throw him down and stone him? Well, you could say, well, you know, Jesus has had quite the following, and they don't want to upset the people and turn people against them. Maybe that's part of it. But there's a way bigger reason they didn't drag him out, throw him down, and stone him. And verse 32 tells us what that reason is. John says this, this fulfilled Jesus' prediction about the way he would die. I cannot express to you how big a statement that is in verse 32. John is pointing to our king and reminding us he's sovereign. Even in this moment when they have bound him up, he is in control. In this moment when they are trying to bring him to his demise, he is sovereign, he is in control. This fulfilled, verse 32, Jesus' prediction about the way that he would die. Listen, if they had walked away with Jesus, if they had dragged Jesus out into the street and thrown him down and stoned him, he would not be the Son of God. He would not be the Savior of the world. Our Bible would not be true. Our faith, Christianity, would go up in flames if that was the way that Jesus had been executed. Why? Because Jesus had already told how he would be executed. John chapter 12, verse 32, Jesus said, "And when I'm lifted up from the earth," not when I'm thrown down on it, "when I'm lifted up from the earth, then I will draw everyone to myself." And then John says, to make sure we know what he's talking about, he said this, verse 33, to indicate how he was going to die. Jesus said, "Here's how I'm going to die. I'm not going to be thrown down. I'm going to be lifted up." That's how the Romans executed criminals. They put them on crosses and they lifted them up. The Jews executed people by throwing them down. The Romans executed people by lifting them up. Jesus said, "I will die by being lifted up, not by being thrown down." Jesus had already prophesied his own crucifixion. If the Jews had taken him and threw him down and stoned him, then Jesus was wrong, and he's all wrong, and he's not God, and he's not the truth, and he's not the way, and he's not the life, and all of Christianity collapses because Jesus is a fraud and he's full of lies. But that's not what happened. They didn't throw him down. He went to the cross. He was lifted up just like he said he would. You know why? Because he's God. He's in control. He's sovereign. The most powerful religion in the world at that time couldn't stop the plan of God. The most powerful empire at that moment in history could not stop the plan of God. There's nothing that can stop the purposes and the plans of God. And we need to be reminded today that our King is sovereign. He has not stepped down from the throne. He has not taken a vacation. He's not taken a nap. There is not one single molecule floating around in the universe that he is not sovereignly governing over. He is our sinless king. And he's our sovereign king. Not only that, but Jesus is our supernatural king. There's none like him. Verse 33, John 18, "Then Pilate went back into his headquarters." They didn't bite. They didn't take the bait and go kill him. So he still got this in his lap. So he goes back to his headquarters and he calls Jesus to come in to see him. And he looks at Jesus and he says, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Now, in the Greek, the word "you" comes first. And it sounds like this: "You? You're the King of the Jews? Are you kidding me? You. You're the King of the Jews. You don't look like a king. Surely you're not. Really? You're the one?" Jesus replied, "Is that your own question? Or did others tell you about me? Do you really want to know who I am? Or are you just asking me because you have to?" In other words, "Pilate, are you accusing me of being a king?" Pilate says in verse 35, "Am I a Jew?" In other words, "I don't care. This has nothing to do with me. Am I a Jew? Your own people and their leading priests brought you to me for trial. Why? What have you done? I couldn't care less about this. I'm just doing my job. Doesn't really matter to me who you are." A lot of people in our world right now, we need to pray for them, because they say, "It doesn't matter to me who Jesus claimed to be. It doesn't matter to me who Jesus was." This is what Paul is saying. "I don't care. It has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with him. He don't know it yet." He knows it now, by the way. Pilate has come to understand it meant everything. I promise you. The best evangelist the world would ever see is if you brought one person back from hell and you gave them 15 minutes on this planet. Pilate's going, I don't care about this. There's no crime. Pilate can't find anything wrong with him. He can't identify anything. And then Jesus answers the question in verse 36. Jesus answered, "My kingdom." So there's your answer. Yes, I am a king. He says, my kingdom is not an earthly kingdom. If it were, my followers would fight to keep me from being handed over to the Jewish leaders. But my kingdom is not of this world. Listen, Jesus is not a king because people elected him to be a king. He's not a king because his granddaddy was a king and his daddy was a king and he got it by inheritance. No, Jesus is king by virtue of who Jesus is. He is king. And in his kingdom, it's a spiritual kingdom. And two times he says, my kingdom, it's not of this world. Jesus is a supernatural king. He didn't look like the kings of this earth for good reason. He's not like the kings of this earth. Pilate was right about that. He doesn't look like an earthly king, but he was dead wrong in thinking that Jesus wasn't a king. He's not just a king, he's the king. He's the King of kings, and he's the Lord of all lords. Revelation chapter 11 says there's a day coming that King Jesus is going to bring before him all the nations of the earth, and all of the rulers and all the pilots of the world are going to stand before him, and they are going to feel the weight of his rule and his reign and his glory upon them as he establishes his kingdom in this world. Jesus is the supernatural king. He said, my kingdom is not of this world. So Pilate said, so you are a king. Jesus responded, you say I'm a king? Actually, I was born and came into the world to testify to the truth. Slow down. Watch this. Jesus just said some massive stuff in that one verse. I need you to see this. He's the supernatural king, right? And here's what Jesus said. Two things in that verse that Jesus said that underscore how supernatural he is. He says, I was born. Norm, we're just having this conversation. You know what Jesus just said when he said that? He said, I'm fully man. I'm a king that's fully man. I was born. That's his humanity. Then he said, and came into the world. I was outside of it, and then I stepped into it. In other words, I existed before I was born. In that little sentence, Jesus just said, I am fully man and fully God. You ever seen a king like that? There's never, ever been a king like that. Never, ever will be a king like that except this king. He's sinless, he's sovereign, and he is supernatural. He has no beginning, he has no end. He was pre-existent before everything was created with God. He was coexisting with God before anything was called into existence. And he was pre-existent and coexistent with God because he is God. He is fully God, fully man. That uniquely qualifies him to be our mediator, to stand in the gap between sinners and God because he is both man and God. There is none other like him. There is no other Savior. There's no other way for you to be reconciled to God as a man except through the God-man himself. He's sovereign, sinless and sovereign and supernatural. And he came to testify about the truth. You say, what truth? The truth about who he is. The truth about the kingdom of God. The truth about eternity. The truth about heaven. The truth about hell. The truth about sin. The truth about salvation. We're living in a day today where people don't believe in absolute truth. They'll say, there's absolutely no absolute truth. Are you absolutely sure about that? Is that the absolute truth? I hadn't thought that argument through too well. Listen, there is absolute truth. In our world today, the world doesn't think so. Today, the world's all about, well, I'm living my truth. You got your truth, I got my truth. There is no truth. No absolute truth. Jesus says otherwise. I am the truth. And he says, all who love the truth recognize that what I say is true. You know why people don't believe Jesus is the truth? Because they don't love him. Yet, but when you tell them about Jesus, and the Holy Spirit draws them to Jesus, and then they love Jesus, then they're going to love Jesus' truth. But right now, they're dead on the inside. You don't love living truth with a dead heart. But God gives a new heart, and you'll love his truth. He'll do that for you today, by the way, if you're here and you've never given your life to Jesus. He'll give you a new life today, new heart. He'll wipe the slate clean. He'll cast your sins as far as the east is from the west. He'll not remember them. He'll not hold them against you ever, 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 ever again. And Pilate says to him, what is truth? This is postmodernism. This is our world we're living in today. Well, there's no such thing as truth. It's just you do your thing and I do my thing and that's all we do. But the truth was standing right in front of Pilate. The truth, not a truth. The truth was standing right in front of Pilate. And then Pilate goes out again to the people. He told them he's not guilty of any crime. John wants us to see Jesus for who he is, church. He's the sinless king. There's no fault in him. He's the sovereign king. He may look like a victim up there, but he's not a victim. He's up there defeating sin. He's up there defeating Satan. He's up there defeating death. He's up there disarming our old slave masters that held us in our chains and in our bondage. He's up there sovereignly orchestrating every detail of his redeeming plan for me and for you. He's the sinless king, and he's the sovereign king, and he's the supernatural king, fully God, fully man, all at the same time. He is heaven's truth, and he's earth's hope. There's none like him. We need to be reminded today of who he is, don't we? Huh? And we need to be doing some reminding of who he is. Our king, he is sinless, and he is sovereign. And he is supernatural. Now, between verse 38 and 39, you see what's in between your verse 38 and 39? I'll tell you nothing. Just white space. But let me tell you what happened between that's a trick question. What happened between verse 38 and 39 is Pilate said, hey, I got to get rid of this guy. I got to get out of this mess. And so he said, hey, King Herod is in town. He's got a palace in Jerusalem. I'm going to dump this on his plate. So he sends Jesus over to visit with King Herod. And Herod don't want to touch him either. Herod just makes it an opportunity to have a little fun. Herod's a weirdo, man. Sicko. He's inherited weirdo, sicko. Right down. You just read your history books on that family. Woo! All right? So Herod turns this whole thing with Jesus standing there into a sideshow, a comedy full of mockery and scorn and ridicule. And Jesus is beaten and his beard is plucked out there. And he's tortured and abused, and then he just sends him back over to Pilate. And verse 39 is where you are now. He comes back to Pilate from having stood in front of Herod, and all Pilate wants to do is get out of this with some semblance of leadership, some semblance of nobility. He knows this is an innocent man. He knows that. He knows the whole thing is a plot by the Jewish leaders just to have Jesus murdered. He's no criminal. He's no threat to anybody, but the Jewish leaders are a threat to Pilate. If he's their lapdog. If he doesn't do what they say do, they're going to tattle on him. So the Jewish people are a threat to him, to Pilate. So his dilemma is clear. Rome wants a fair and just trial. The Jewish people, they just want to knock this guy off. Pilate's trapped. There's got to be a way out. The Jewish people wouldn't do it for him. Herod wouldn't do it for him. Pilate's got one last idea. So we pick that up. Verse 39. And it's here that John points us to this. Not only is Jesus our sinless king, and not only is he our sovereign king, and not only is he our supernatural king, Jesus is also our substituting king. Watch this. Verse 39, Pilate goes, but you have a custom. Looking at the Jewish people, hey, you got a tradition. Every year, you ask me to release one prisoner at Passover. Pilate, we think, started this tradition as a way to try to appease the Jewish people a little bit. You know, if you think one of your people has been unjustly placed in prison, you want to select that one to be free. We'll do that at Passover every year. And so Pilate says, I got a plan. I know how I'm going to get this off my hands. I'm going to go back here in the prison. I'm going to grab the worst criminal we have. And I'm going to bring him out, and I'm going to stand him next to Jesus. I'm going to say, which one do you want me to let go? And that'll be a no-brainer. They'll go, dog, if I got to choose, then just let Jesus go. We can't let that guy go. I mean, he's like the Jeffrey Dahmer of Jerusalem, right? Can't have this guy out there running on the streets anymore. So this is Pilate's plan. And so he does this, and he says, who do you want me to release? This king of the Jews? The crowd's growing and growing, right? And Pilate's standing there with Jesus, and now this man, this prisoner named Barabbas. The Bible says he's a notorious criminal. Other gospel writers will tell us that he's a murderer. And here's the worst offender. And here's the sinless, sovereign, supernatural Son of God who's about to become the worst offender substitute. Verse 39, you have a custom of asking me to release one prisoner each year at Passover. Would you like me to release this king of the Jews? But they shouted back, no, not this man. We want Barabbas. Barabbas means son of the Father. Father, the devil. You have the Son of God and the son of the devil. And they chose to kill the Son of God. Why did they make such a terrible choice? Because this is the unstoppable plan of God. God had planned before time began that King Jesus would one day substitute himself for the vilest offenders, of whom I am one. And before a holy God, so are you. Filthy rags in his sight. Every week I talk with the children, Adam and Eve. God created two people. What were their names? Adam and Eve. Did they obey or disobey God? They disobeyed. What's the Bible call it? The Bible calls that sin. Even though they sinned, God stepped into the garden and he made them a promise. He promised to send a Savior. You know what God did in Genesis chapter 3 when Adam and Eve sinned against God? They should have died. That was the penalty of sin. God had already spelled that out for them. You don't do that or you're going to die. He'd already spelled it out. But they didn't die in that moment. Instead, God went to an animal. He chose a substitute for Adam and Eve, and God killed that animal. And he took the skins of that animal to cover the shame and the guilt of Adam and Eve. Their son, Abel, he does the same thing. He chooses a substitute for himself. In his place, the sacrifice dies. Abraham takes his son Isaac up to the top of Mount Moriah. God says, you offer him as a sacrifice. And just before he slit his son's throat, God said, hey, I want to teach you something. I'm going to teach you the principle of substitute. Instead of Isaac dying, I have an animal over here in this thicket, and he'll substitute in for Isaac. God has been painting a picture since Genesis chapter 3 that this world needs a substitute, somebody that would step in our place and take our penalty and take our punishment and take our sin. And Jesus is doing this right here in this text. He is our sinless, sovereign, supernatural, substituting King. He's the Lamb of God taking the place of sinners and taking sin away. Jesus took Barabbas' place, and Barabbas walked away a free man. Dawson, Jesus took my place, and I walked away a free man. And I've been free ever since. The Bible says, who he sets free is free indeed. There's therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And we just need to hear that again today. We need to be reminded of that again today. He took my cross and my sin and my place, and I took his righteousness by grace through faith as my own. Listen, here's bad news, world. The bad news is God requires us to be righteous. If you want to live with God forever, you want to have your relationship with God, God requires that you be righteous. That's bad news. The good news is God requires, God provides what he requires. That's the good news. He provides what he requires. None of us would ever be able to be righteous on our own. So God provided us righteousness through Jesus substituting himself in our place. Jesus is my sinless King. He's my sovereign King. He's my supernatural King. He's my substituting King. But we cannot forget, this all comes at a price. He's our suffering King. Suffered much for you and for me. When he substituted in my place, he took my suffering. And I just want to read the first few verses of John chapter 19. Then Pilate, he's thinking, they're not taking the bait. I can't kill this guy. He's innocent. He has one last idea. I am going to beat him to a pulp. And I'm going to shock the people by what I've done to this man. And they'll be satisfied. They'll say, okay, we're happy. He got what he deserved. And they'll back off. So the Bible says in chapter 19, verse 1, then Pilate had Jesus flogged with a lead-tipped whip. The reason it was had lead on the ends of it is because that would act like a tenderizer. And it would tenderize his flesh and his meat, the muscles. so that the skin would more easily tear. Other pieces of that leather strap had sharp objects embedded in it. And by the time the flesh had been tenderized, now those sharp objects go deep within the flesh, and his flesh is ripped off with every blow, with every lash. Every part of his body was covered, front, back, head to toe. And verse 2 says, the soldiers wove a crown of thorns, and they put it on his head, and they put a purple robe on him. Remember back to Genesis chapter 3 when Adam and Eve sinned, and God gave a curse, and he said, you're going to have to deal with thorns now. At the cross, Jesus is wearing our curse on his head so that you and I, by his grace, could wear his glory on ours. In verse 3, they said, hail, King of the Jews. They mocked as they slapped him again and again across the face. And Pilate went outside again to the people. He's thinking, okay, this is going to shock them. When I peel the robe off this guy and he don't even look recognizable like a man anymore, they'll go home. So Pilate goes outside again. And he said to the people, I'm going to bring him out to you now. Drama, right? Setting the stage. I'm going to bring him out to you now. But understand, clearly, I find him not guilty. I want you to see what I did to an innocent man. And you tell me where we're going to go from here. Any decent person's going to go, that's enough, that's enough, that's enough. And then Jesus came out wearing our curse on his head and a faded out Roman robe that had gone from purple or from red to purple in the fading probably. And Pilate said, look, here's the man. And when they saw him, the leading priest and the temple guards began shouting, crucify him. Crucify him. And Pilate said, take him yourselves and crucify him. I find him not guilty. Not guilty. Pilate wasn't a good politician, but he was a pretty good judge. Jesus wasn't guilty. We were. But our guilt was laid on him. And today, we just needed to be reminded in the middle of all this madness who Jesus is. He is King. He's sinless King. He's sovereign King. He's supernatural King. He's substituting King. He's suffering King. Have you bowed your knee to this King? If you confess with your mouth that he's your King, you will. But if you don't in this life, you will in the next, and it'll be too late. The Bible says every knee is going to bow. Every knee. Every tongue is going to confess that he is King, that he is Lord. Do you know today that you've bowed your knee and said, Jesus, you're my King. You're my Lord. You rule over me. You reign over me. My thoughts are under your authority. My mouth is under your authority. My life is under your authority. My decision making is under your authority. You're a good King. You are just and you are kind and you're full of mercy and you are full of grace. And I would be a fool to say no to a King like you, a King who rules the entire world, the King who holds all things together, the King who there is nothing in his kingdom in which he is not sovereign over. Yes, I willingly, excitedly, thankfully place my life underneath your kingship, your rule, your authority. Have you done that? I'm not asking, have you prayed a prayer? Is he the King of your life? He's not sharing the throne with you. There's only one who's worthy to sit on that throne. He's not sharing his glory with another. He's not asking you to be co-king with him, co-ruler with him. Hey, we'll have a powwow, and together we'll figure out what's going to happen in your life. No, God said, no, I'll tell you, because I'm King. I'm not here to be your buddy. I'm here to be your King. We're losing sight of that in our world today. And one day, Chris, we're going to stand before God. And what he's not going to say to me is, well done, my good and faithful King. I pray he'll look at me and say, well done, my good and faithful servant. You bowed your life to me. You gave me complete rule and sovereignty over your life. You died to yourself. You were raised with me. It was no longer you that lived your life, but it was me that lived it through you. You were just my servant, and I'm telling you, well done. My translation, hey, Joel, way to get out of my way and let me live through you. That's all he's asking you to do today. Young people, I'm not putting a to-do list up here in front of you. Church kids, we've heard it our whole life. You got to do this and do that and don't do this and don't do that. I don't have a to-do list. I got a, it's a done list. Jesus has done it. He's paid it all. All he's asking you to do is stop living for yourself and make him your king. Say, God, my life is yours, every part of it. You guide me. You lead me. I'm not going to step where you don't tell me to step. I'll go this way, you say go this way. I'll do this when you say do this. And until you say it, I'm not moving. Is he your king today? Is he your king today? Is he your king? Would you make him your king today if he's not? And by the way, you don't have to make him king. He is king. Whether you make him king or not, he is king. You're either submitting to his kingship or you're rebelling against his kingship. Where are you today? Where are you today? He's such a good king. There's none like him. And when we walk out of here today, if he's our king, if he's really our king, you know how you'll know he's your king? Because you're going to talk about him. You're going to tell other people, you got to know about my king. I want you to know him. I want you to know him. Right now, our world, they're looking. They're looking for somebody that's in charge. Hey, look no further. We have a king. There is none, never will be another like our King. Do you know him today? Let's pray. God, we bow our hearts before you today. So grateful for your Son, Jesus, our King. None like him, perfect, flawless, sinless, sovereignly ruling and reigning over everything in this world. Supernatural, none like him, fully God, fully man. Only one qualified to stand between us and you. Only one qualified to make us right with you. Substituting king who put himself in my place. That should have been me that suffered under the wrath of God because of my sin. But he substituted himself. He took my cross. He took the penalty of my sin, took my suffering, took my shame, and gave me his righteousness. God, that you would say about me right now that I belong to you and that in me you're well pleased. You say that only because you see the righteousness of Jesus on me. I praise you for that. I thank you for that. We recognize today, Jesus, that what we're rejoicing in today cost you dearly. And one day we're going to be in a place where all is made right and everything is healed. And we're going to look on your scars. We're going to be reminded that because of your love for us, Jesus, and for your commitment to the glory of your Father, Jesus, you forever, forever altered your eternal existence. You'll bear the scars for all of eternity. We'll look on you and we'll be reminded that there is no other king that would have done such a thing. Not for somebody like me. Holy Spirit, would you do what you're always faithful to do right now? Just exalt Jesus in this room. Call us to submit fully to his kingship over our lives. Some of us have got to stop trying to wiggle into his throne and find full joy at his feet. You lift Jesus up, Holy Spirit, not only in this room, but in this world. Today. Would you you show the world the hope that we have in Jesus. Our hope is not in who governs us. Our hope is not in cures for diseases. The reality is the most deadly disease is the one that damns us to an eternal hell, a disease called sin. And Jesus is the only cure. God, for those in the room that have never put their trust in Jesus, never said, Jesus, you are King, and I recognize that, and I yield to you. I pray they would do that today. For those that have done that, but sin nature has taken hold and tried to wiggle our way back into the place of being our own King, God, would you bring us to repentance, make us right with yourself again. We want to be good and faithful servants. Begin to sing in just a minute. I want to invite you to be obedient to the Lord today, whatever that may look like. Maybe getting on your face at this altar before the Lord. It may be putting your face in your chair and making that an altar where you just seek the Lord. It may be just standing there with arms lifted, just praising Him for what a glorious King that He is. I don't know that we'll be here next week. I don't know that we'll be here the week after that or the week after that. Feel an urgency in this moment that we need to maximize our opportunity today in this place to humble ourselves together before Jesus, to seek His face. All weekend, I've been preaching the text that they selected for me about 3 months ago, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people called by my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. I believe that. Let's stand before the Lord. Let's step out in obedience today.
My gaze. This is the face a falling heart. For your throne of grace, of crying out, I need you now. Reach out and make me new. This is my life, my Lord, my God. It's all for you, it's all for you.
Come on.
I crown you King, my everything. King of my heart, King of my heart. Oh, majesty, take all of me. I crown.
Just how broken our world is, and just how fragile it is, and just how desperately in need of a shepherd it is, how desperately in need of a Savior it is. God, we need you. And we've been reminded how deep our longing is for heaven. To see you face to face and all the turmoil and all the struggle, all the confusion, all the pain, all the depression, all the fear, all the discouragement, all the disease has been vanquished by the power of your beautiful name. You have given us hope, and you've called us to be carriers of that hope. The best thing that might happen to the church is if we walked out of this room just thinking to ourselves, you know what? This old virus might kill me by Friday. If you knew that was going to happen, and you believed everything that you say you believe, I believe you'd be a man or a woman on a mission this week. Well, let me tell you this. I don't think coronavirus is going to kill you. But one day you will die. And you don't know when that day is going to be. If you went to as many funerals as I went to, you'd walk with a lot more awareness of your own mortality. I promise you that. But we all have an expiration date. We just don't know. It ain't stamped on us like your milk jug, you know. But it's coming. So what are you going to do with this day? You going to spend it talking about a virus? We can't talk about sports no more. Praise the God. He's toppling over all our idols. Right? We ain't got many more gods left to talk about, do we? Except the one true God. Ha! Hey! I think we might be onto something here, right? What are you going to do with this day and the next day? You got extra time on your hands. What you don't want to do is stand before Jesus one day and he says, hey, remember down in 2020, I gave you some extra time, and you know what you did with it, servant? Nothing. You dug a hole and you buried it. You didn't do nothing with it. What if this is the mission strategy from Jesus in these last days? That something just happens in his church like has never happened before. We ain't watching Final Four. We can't go watch Chase Lee throw the tater no more down at Bama. Can't do none of that stuff anymore. What are we going to do with the time that we have? I hear what some of y'all say, I'm going to binge my shows. Who's your king? Come on. Y'all, I'm just a little giddy about what God, I think, might be up to in this. I don't want people to get sick, certainly. I don't want people to die, certainly. But you know what? I want people to know sickness is real, death is real, and Jesus is even more real than all that. Hey, let's get after it, y'all. Let's get after it. You get before the Lord, you say, Lord, here I am, your servant. Go send me. You tell me what to do. What does that look like? How do I do that? Capture your... Everybody's on social media as if they could be on it anymore. Now they're on it even more than they were, trying to find out what's the latest, what's the latest. Change the conversation. Change the conversation in your head to the gospel. Change the conversation coming out of your mouth to the gospel. We got a glorious king, a good king, a coming soon king, and we need to be proclaiming that message. Can I get an amen? Amen. Amen. Let us not waste these days that we're in. You college students, you don't have to go to class anymore. I know online stuff. You probably already got it done. It's already done. It ain't no big deal. What are we going to do with this time, y'all? I don't know. I can't tell you. You know? But if we get quarantined, I'm just reminded Paul accomplished more for the kingdom of God in a prison cell. All right? Come on, y'all. Our children may look back on this and go, man alive, what we saw God do in those days. Because mom and dad just said yes to Jesus. Amen. I hope I get to see you face to face next week. I don't know, but I'll try to let you know by Friday. Again, we might just find us an oak tree, and I might just preach about a dozen times next week to 50 people that'll pop. That's all right. I don't care. All right? All right. Man, I love you. I could hang out with you all day. I feel like I might ought to. But you got to go. Hey, let's get out of here. We got a job to do, y'all. A glorious job to do. Let's go. I love you guys. Get after it.